So let's get started with our last presenter. So welcome, Ilaria Marenko. She will talk us about Omero. So I will let you.
Okay. Yes. Thank you very much. And thanks for everyone who is here listening to me. So my name is Ilaria, and I work in the Falkland Islands for the South Atlantic Environmental Research Institute. And I've been as a GIS specialist and data manager. Since May, I've been working and looking at this tool called Omero, which is open source and then is image catalog. So it's a client and server service for managing data and images. So the Omero actually started in the life science environment, so nothing to do with geography or geospatial. And what happened there is that in 2002, there was this, the project started, funded and completed by government and public money. So it was open source also from the beginning. And the problem that the scientists had in life science was they generated a lot of images, and they needed to have some tool able to manage those images and make them accessible, available to many people working in the same research group. Those images needed to be searchable and then at the same time documented. So the project started in Dundee and then is currently maintained by these guys and more people actually behind it. This is only the core team in Dundee, at the Dundee University. There is already a community, so it's been the tool itself is very used or well used in life science. And there is a forum, and what Omero does is actually a full data management of those images. So it takes care of the documentation, as I said, or the indices and tagging and things like that. So when it happened that I was reading various things, papers, and then I found out about it. And then I work with environmental scientists. So through my work, I just noticed that, and then you know this one, so we use, these researchers use different types of cameras in their field work, and then what they do is they collect basically data. And so as you can see, it can be a drone, can be a camera trap, or a drop-down camera. And then at the end, what you get is always are images, are pictures. And some of these are simply are going to be used later on for blogs, reports, or newsletter. So they simply record the event, what happened the day. But other images are actually collected and then analyzed later on. And so you might have people that are looking at identifying dolphins or whales from their fin, or counting penguins, albatrosses, this is the case down in the Falklands, or identifying species on the seabed, looking at how areas of conservation are basically successful or not by looking at the number of plants that have been planted and growing and so on. So basically the problem was the same. We've got images, and then these images are data, and they needed to be managed at some point because basically it becomes a problem. And then the problem essentially is the same one that the people in life science had. And essentially is what happens to those images the majority of the time, and they are just thrown and put into the file system. Sometimes you might have people that are quite educated, so they do a proper naming of all the folders, and then so it's easier to find the images afterwards, after everyone comes back to the office after the field season. But generally speaking, even if the file system is pretty much tidy, it makes sense the majority of the time only to the person who actually created it. And the majority of the time is actually a big mess, and then it's very difficult then to retrieve this information. So for instance, if you decided to say, okay, let's search for those colonies of penguins that have gone, that have got more than 100 breeding pairs. And the image has been already analyzed at some point in the workflow. Generally, the scientist what would do is open an Excel file the majority of the time. 5% probably this table is actually in a proper database. So the person can run an SQL query, but generally it will sort by the column called count. But then the problem is, okay, where are the images? So as for maps, we use maps because it's much easier to visualize what is happening. And the same thing is for the images. So that in case of colonies, animals change also location. So you might have a penguin colony in up position today with a number of breeding pairs, but then this one can change and then it can move even 100, 300, or even a kilometer. So you want also to see that one with your data. So the point is to have more intelligent searches and say, okay, what if I can also search the images straight away? And not only, and so that I link together the data and the images in the same place. And so the answer for me was, yes, this one is quite cool, and then it can work, but you need a database, or at least you need one repository. You needed to tag your images, and then you needed to create basically this sort of link between these two objects, data and images. And then again, you, because you enter into a proper system, you can set up users, groups, and permissions. So the schema that I just took from what the guys are using in the life science is pretty simple, even if then everything else at the back end is actually a little bit more complex. So you've got your raw data, you've got your process data, then you've got your database. In this case, is everything is in Postgres. And then you can run your quantitative analysis outside Homero, not in Homero, because Homero is only an image catalog. And then, but what you do is then you bring some of this data with your image in the same container, and then you visualize. So how Homero looks like? As I said to you, is a web client server tool, and so I'm just focusing on the front end. The back end is more for developers, and everything is completely documented on the links that I gave at the beginning in GitHub. So every one of you who is really keen and want to know more about the back end can just read the docs. But the front end looks like a simple web interface, and so you've got you import the images using a second tool, and you've got only three main containers. So there is a project, there is the dataset, and then straight away there are the images. So you don't need to create 1,000 folders within the main folder. It's only two levels, and this one is simply because when you import the images, you tag them. So actually, it's easy to search then the image because everything is going to be tagged. And so you can create your list of tag. Whoever comes and wants to tag also the image finds already the tag there, so you don't have to duplicate tags. Tags will be there. Tags are also managed by the administrator so that there is no duplication. And all of these, also the admin of tags, annotation, you will see you can have a rating of the images and so on, is all done by through scripts. And then at the back, the language for the scripts is Python. So as I said, there are tags, and there are different ways of searching. So you search for one specific tag, or you can search for two tags. So like if I've got an image that, like in this example, has got three or four tags, you can start with one, and then if there are other connected to that one, you can also add them until you basically get to those that are exactly the one, two, three, and four tags that you're looking for. So you can narrow down. Similarly, you can also search images based on various objects. So tags is one, but also rating. So you can mix the two. And then if you've got a key value, you can also add those. So your search is actually running on more than one annotation and one object that you created. Then, of course, it's a tool for also visualizing. And the good things about this one is so you can modify and change saturation and things, but you can also take your images and create already kind of a nice image with caption that then can be exported and then it can be usable for a scientific paper, for example. This one was the case for the life science guys that really needed as well to report back and then have these images for presentation and papers. And then, as I said to you, because this one is a proper system, so we are talking about a database, a catalog, you create your user, and then you've got groups, and then there are permissions. So this one is typical for this kind of systems. So generally, you can also decide to give to create a specific group that is called the public group. And then all the images that are placed in this public group are available to the general public. So there is a way for sharing still internally within people that are working in the same group. And in this case, keep the data open only to this small environment, but it's also possible to create a specific one where the user, actually the public user, you need only to give the URL of where you are publishing your service, and then it will get straight away to these images. And it will get to the main page of Homero. The good things about Homero is that it integrates with other tools like R or MATLAB, and integrates as well with other image analysis tools. In this case, for example, what you see there is an otolith slide. So the otoliths are the bones that fish, well, is the ear bone of the fish. And the scientists used to read, well, to slice the bone and then read the age and get age and maturity and sex of the fish. So essentially, the person who provided me with the script worked entirely in R, so didn't know anything about Homero, because it's something that new that I presented to the guys in the Falklands. But what happened there is that we just changed slightly the shape R package, and this one became shape RO, just to give a little bit of Homero at the end. But the main changes is only in the connection, and everything else, the rest of the script was exactly what the scientist wrote in for his project. But the good things is that at the end, you can import the results back into Homero, so that there will be 100 slides of otoliths, or whatever number of otoliths bones were analyzed, and then you attach back your all the results. So then afterwards, you can just search for example, age greater than 10 years or less than 10 years and so on and so forth, and then you retrieve as well your images. So, and this one again speeds up and then make more effective the work that the researchers were trying to achieve. And the other one that I was saying is that the connection between Homero and some software that they do image analysis. Again, what you see there is only, again, is a software developed for that specific life science group of scientists. However, I tested on an albatross colony, and what was going on in the Falklands, I had, there are some various albatross colony on the islands. And then there is a monitoring project every year so that a drone is flown over the colonies, and then manually the person has to sit down and count the either penguins or albatrosses. And, you know, it's a kind of a laborious work. And so in order to, again, speed up the data system, I try to use this Orbit tool. And then essentially works as a simple image segmentation. So you can do this one also with as if you have a raster file and then you wanted to classify, for example, habitats, same things. You need to train the model, and then you get your the number of objects, you classify all the albatrosses, and then again you run a script. This time again is a Python script, and then you bring back into the main image catalog the all the objects or the segmented objects, and which are the albatrosses in this case. And these objects are imported as ROIs in Omero, and then again you can make your search, and then you can search into the entire catalog for colonies of albatrosses with a number greater than and whatever number you want to put. So again, this one, in this way, I was achieving, we were achieving basically two things. First of all, we were speeding the process, automating basically the process of identifying albatrosses, not more manual, but using segmentation. So image analysis, and the other one was when you get straight away your number, you can search very quickly your images with the value that you want. So in conclusion, is actually there is not a proper conclusion for me right now, except that it's what we are going to do next. So as I said, I started working on and exploring how the tool can be used also in the environmental science, where there is problem in managing images, that type of images that you saw. And therefore, at the moment, I'm going back to the Falklands. I'm going to deploy the tool on our local server. And then I'm using the researchers in the Falklands that already provided me with the images that I used for my pilot studies. And they will be the guinea pigs. So we'll collect the feedback. We'll see really how this tool can work, if it still needs more customization, because it's entirely customizable. I wrote probably with the help of the developers in Dundee something like 20 scripts just to fit a little bit what the researchers asked already back in January when I just gave a small presentation on this tool. And yes, and so then I want to practice more really this sort of interoperability with R and in this case Orbit or Fiji, because I know that the researchers are already using Fiji, for example, and I wanted just to see if it works, and then if I can give them a tool that manages images and allows them also to do some calculation and analysis, I will be happy, because it's basically my job there just to do data management and facilitating their work. So, yeah, and then if everything really goes well, then probably other people will be interested in using, and we spread the use of this tool outside the Falklands. So, said this one, thank you very much for listening, and if you've got any question, let me know.
Are there any questions? Oh, all right. Sorry.
So thanks for the presentation. And I was wondering if there is any support for tracking the provenance of the images, because maybe I have like a an image of a penguin colony and some Python script that counts them, and maybe it's called copy of count penguins august21.py, and I get a result of the resulting image or data set, and then maybe a month later I want to know from which input image that was produced and with which version of the Python script, because maybe I have like 20 versions of that script lying around and I'm not sure which one was used at the time.
So yes, so if you want you can, when you run the script you can probably either add, the script allows you to add annotation as well. So you do the calculation and then you add an annotation in the key value pairs, which is basically key and value, and then you can run a script where you say, okay, take the name of the Python script that you run at the time and then add it there. And then it will be just a line in this annotation so that, again, this one stays with the image. And then, if you want to search afterwards, you will know. But it won't be complicated. As I said, I'm not a developer. So I started using this one and learning while I was doing that, and then it's possible. It's not, after a while, it's not too complex. Yeah.
Any other?
Maybe you already said this, but if you have an image taken with a certain camera, it might add a lot of its own metadata.
Yeah.
So there might be GPS and mm-hmm. optical properties.
Yep.
So you collect that automatically in
yes.
the system?
Okay. Yeah. So the because, again, the tool was built for life science, there is one element of Homero is, it's actually just a different component, it's outside Homero, but it's called the bioformat. So they read lots of different formats, and the metadata, the raw image is not changed, it's actually completely there. And then in the first, I don't know how clear it can be, but in here, you've got something called the dataset details, and then the metadata coming from the camera is all there. Yeah. And when you import the tool works also in a way that you can have your data into the server. When you deploy Homero on a server, you can actually bring your images into the same server, or you can have what is called an in-place import, so you keep your images on a separate server and then you create a link. Of course, then if you move the images somewhere, then you break the links and then it's a problem. But it does also that. And nothing is done on the raw image, but it's on, it's just a visual for on the web. Yeah.
Any more questions?
Thanks. Is the analysis of the images done in bulk? I mean,
yes, okay. Of course, yes. It's all the, so here, I didn't actually have any print screen, but yes, you can, you write your script and then you can import images in bulk. You can apply any type of analysis that you wrote your code on bulk images. Each image basically is has got an index, so there is an ID, and then each tag has got an ID, and then there is a link between tag and objects. So there are various rules, of course, also about tagging and then annotating an image, but yes, indeed. Bulk things is you can do it.
That's great.
And also, as I said, you've got a project data set and images. You can work on these three levels, and then you can say, okay, run things at the you import something at the data set level, and then you've got also the option to run everything into the child. So everything that is under that data set will be analyzed.
Okay. And can you search or for example, you have an image that contains, I don't know, penguins and albatrosses.
Yep.
But at one time, do you only search for penguins, and at another time, you search for albatrosses, or does it do the tagging in the same time for both of them or for everything that it has?
So if you have, you can search for separately, because if you use, depends on actually the tool that you're working. So if there are at least three different search tools, there is only specific tag tool. So in this case, if an image is penguin and another one is albatross, you can't search both together. But then there is another tool that allows you then to do an AND, so a logical search. So then you can have, for instance, if you are into your key value pair, you've got a species name, penguin, just in general, and then or species name albatross. And this one will bring you both. Yeah.
Yeah. Any more questions? Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you to you.